And I was just not that kind of student. Like, when the class was never done for me. And whether that was a matter, and I'm sure you probably still do this too, I threw nothing away, and I continue to go back to things and go, oh my goodness, like, oh, that makes so much more sense. I really understand that thing now. Or, you know, years later, I still have no idea what this is. Okay, let me plug that in. Because I didn't know then, I don't know now. You know, let me make those things a better reality for myself. And that's been a really important aspect for me and my own personal growth, is just trying to go back and plug in and understand and receive things, just a little differently. And I think I teach too a lot differently, because I'm so passionate about the students getting it versus getting the A.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Everything Band, a podcast that features conversations with composers, conductors, and performers of music for winds and percussion. My name is Mark Connor. I'm a composer and educator, and each week I have the great fortune to speak with and share the stories and wisdom of musicians and leaders in the band community. The Everything Band podcast is a proud member of the Music Teachers Development Podcast Network. The Muted Network provides support in the form of audio on-demand programming designed by and for music educators. You can find more information about our network at mutedpodcasts.com. Before we begin, I'd like to thank all of you for listening. I really appreciate your time and hope that you are finding value from these interviews. I rely on word of mouth and social media to bring the show to new listeners. If you think you know one or two people who might find these interviews useful, please let them know about it. You can also help by following me and sharing posts on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. Remember, help your students live up to the best that is in them through music. And now, on to my next guest, André Feagin. Hi, André.
Hi, sir.
So I did your name okay?
You did my name great. It's always the slight pause. I tell people, they think André is one word, and I say, no, there's a period, so we have to have a slight pause. André, see, boom, there we go. It's like a rhythm game.
Sure. So can you introduce yourself? Tell everyone where you are and what you do.
Sure. I am the assistant director of bands and assistant professor of music at Colorado State University in beautiful Fort Collins, Colorado. And here at the university, I conduct the symphonic band. I teach the CSU marching band, the presidential pep band, the basketball pep band. I also teach undergraduate conducting and marching band techniques here.
André, can you talk about your origin story, how you got into music, maybe the early years?
This is really a funny story, and I enjoy telling it a lot. My way into music was via my cousin. And if a long story short, my cousin decided on a whim to join a band, and my family was super excited about it, and I wasn't very interested in it at the time. And I was really frustrated over a great period of time of listening to my family praise my cousin about how special and awesome she was, because she was, joining band, and everybody thought that was amazing. And so I wanted people to think that what I was doing was amazing. So on a whim, I just decided to, hey, I'm going to join a band too. And when I finally did, it did not get the reception that my cousin got. So I got in a band for all the wrong reasons, because I was jealous of my cousin. But it turned out to be the greatest thing to ever happen to me. So that's the opening story. It had nothing about, I wasn't, a big musical family. I'm one of the only musicians, in my family. So it was pretty random, and it was pretty random that I joined band, but it has been the joy of my life.
Excellent. And so what's your instrument?
Clarinet.
And so how did you start playing the clarinet?
You have to, some trial and errors on some instruments, and just really being attuned to qualities of sound and feeling really strongly about the sonority of the instrument. And then hearing some fantastic players of course. And it's just the one that stuck with me. And I play saxophone as well, because that's the thing to double. And that's been fun.
All right, so let me ask you, for my own benefit and maybe the listeners, fourth grade beginners, they've got little hands. Right hand down for G?
You know what? For me, I say yes. We get those hands around as soon as possible. And we can build that as a part of your technique. I think it makes later how you're playing through the break and how you're playing from a quality of sound standpoint significantly better. There, you know, the middle school teacher is going to thank you and the high school teacher is going to love you.
Well, I go back and forth because as you read the various people who do clarinet pedagogy, you get some differing opinions on that for sure.
Right.
All right. Anyway, as a non-clarinetist, that's one of my big questions.
Sound is first, and that will help, right? That will help.
So can you tell me, where are you from? Where'd you grow up?
A little all over the place, but I graduated from Hoover High School in Hoover, Alabama. It's a football place, and people probably know of that school from watching Two A Days on MTV or from the dynamic athletic program that's at the school, as well as the arts, a fantastic drama program. The choir has always been amazing. The band has always been amazing.
So, Teandre, do you have any exceptional teachers from middle school or high school whose techniques of teaching and things that you have brought with you into your own current teaching?
Absolutely. I'm thinking and would like just to send a great shout out to my middle school band director and my two high school band directors, Sally Vimes-White, Pat Morrow, and Derry Pilkington. What I remember most about all three of them was everything had a process. And I challenge everyone to really be patient through all of the process that it takes to really be a great musician, and whether you're learning how to open the case or how to come into the room and set the environment and the atmosphere for learning and for music making, that's been the thing that has resonated the most with me. I take those lessons about process and environment and atmosphere into every rehearsal and classroom that I teach to this very day. It is everything. Setting up an environment where learning is possible, and students are excited about that. And sometimes it's very challenging because it deals sometimes often a lot with how we deal with and expectations for classroom management. But it's very important that there's a process in place and that you're patient through those process.
And so after high school, you went to the University of Memphis. Is that correct?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And so can you tell me about that?
That's a great place and the great school. I probably had my first experience with dynamic teachers at that institution. My clarinet professor, who's now retired, but Jim Golson, again, was a master of process. He was also a fantastic musician. And again, it seemed like a great rite of passage from the training that I had acquired and the atmosphere surrounding that training, I thought went hand in hand at the University of Memphis. Also did my master's there in conducting, and my conducting teacher was another great musician who was all about process and really developing me at the individual level. And I think that's so important as it relates to conducting, and whether people are thinking about going to study conducting, it's great to do it in an environment and an atmosphere where you feel your teacher is bringing out the best musician in you, not trying to turn you into a clone of them. And so I was really, really appreciative of that. I was really able to find my own with some incredible guidance. And the ensembles there are phenomenal. And so it was a great musical environment beyond my individual instruction.
Mm-hmm. And so I'm just trying to piece together a sort of a timeline. So did you teach high school after your degree at Memphis, or did you continue on?
Yes. Yes. I was the director of bands at Watkins Overton High School in Memphis, Tennessee. It's a performing arts high school in Memphis, not very far away from the university. Long, rich tradition of musical excellence At that institution, I was very fortunate to teach at that school with some fantastic colleagues. And of course, it's always good to be able to be in a situation where you can apply your training to reality. And so that was a really, really, really great, healthy experience. And I know that you didn't ask this question, but I'm going to say it anyway. I often recommend that people do that. You know, I get phone calls all the time from former students who say things like, well, I'm not sure if it's time for me to go back to school. And I say, well, here's that method. Do you feel like you have really maxed out what your program is doing, and do you feel like that you have reached a level of growth that now you need to be pushed? And if the answers are yes and yes, then it's time to do that. It's easier sometimes to stay in school and to press through, because you get to avoid some of those life things like major bills and things of that nature. It's really weird and really hard, and I had to do that twice to have a steady job and to be making money and then to take dramatic pay cuts so that you can go and better yourself. It's more challenging, but I tell you that it makes you a much better student. I think from a musical standpoint, from a professionalism standpoint, from a quality of the expectations that you have about music making. I think all of that stuff was different for me as I attended graduate school than some of the colleagues that I had in graduate school, because I had that experience to go along with my education, where some of my fellow classmates didn't.
Yeah, I think it makes a huge difference. I know after I taught high school for 4 years, when I went back and got my doctorate, it was difficult, but it wasn't as difficult as teaching.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So if people can, put in some time, test your skills, see what really discover what you don't, and embrace that. And then when you feel that it's time to move forward, then do so. I think the experience and your education is going to be more enriched because you made that choice.
How long did you teach at Watkins Overton High School?
I was at Watkins Overton for 2.5 years.
Okay. And so another big part of your biography, as I look through this, is the DCI piece. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me what's one of the topics that doesn't come up a lot on my show, because I'm not a marching person. I did my 2 years in my college marching band for my degree. And then that was kind of the end of my involvement. And so we don't talk about it a lot. So I'm wondering if maybe you could talk about your DCI stuff.
Well, sure. I've been in drum corps a very long time. I started drum corps when I was 17 years old, and that was a long time ago. I want to throw my age out there because I still feel young. But I grew up in the activity, and it was an incredible place. It was one of the places I really felt that I grew as a person and as a musician. I marched in the Phantom Regiment Drum and Bugle Corps, and once I aged out of drum corps in the early 2000s, had a great opportunity to teach alongside some great mentors that had once taught me, and I've still been in that activity ever since. I right now am on the staff with the Boston Crusaders, and again surrounded by some fantastic colleagues, led by a really incredible team, and it's the joy of watching what is possible for young people is the thing that keeps me going back. And every year as a member, I think at this, being on staff as well, it's one of those things where you say, I'm never going to do this again. And then you get home and realize what you gained, what you learned, how incredible the environment and atmosphere is. It's kind of a little the drum corps bug, what I call it. And it's been an absolute joy. I think in retrospect, I certainly enjoy it now more than I did when I was a member, and mainly because I'm just at a place now, think through experience where I understand what's happening and that, and the great development that's taking place. And I didn't understand that when I was a member, I just thought Drum Corps was very cool. And yet it was the hardest thing, you know, in life to figure out. And it's still very challenging. Don't get me wrong, but I have just a different perspective on just what it does for young people. That's, you know, really exciting.
So when did you know that you wanted to be a professional musician?
A challenging question, but maybe not really. I'm sure around my junior, senior year of high school is when I knew that I wanted to be a professional musician. And I didn't quite know what path that was going to take. For a long time, I wanted to be an orchestral player. But I had a passion for conducting for a very long time. But I think that came up a little later. I knew I loved music, through my high school experience. And so I knew I wanted to, you know, stay involved and active in it, but probably wasn't until later high school, early college where I said, this is going to be my life.
And so after your teaching, the high school in Memphis, did you go on to your doctorate immediately?
Yes, I did. I went and started my doctorate. I went to the University of North Texas, and while I was there, I won my first college job.
Oh wow!
And so it was a fantastic opportunity, and had some great support from my mentors. And so I went and did that, and I taught at the University of Texas at El Paso, in El Paso, Texas, and that was an incredible experience, and I learned so much about me and about music and about that region of the country, which up until that point I had really never been in. The Mexican American population at the university is the largest in the country. So just the cultural experience, some fantastic colleagues and mentors. In that job, it was a really special time and a really special place, a place I will always remember, because it was my first.
What were you doing in that job?
I was the associate director of bands, and a similar role to what I'm doing now. I taught the second concert band there, and I taught the all of the athletic bands. And then over the course of my 4 years there, I taught an array of things. I taught fundamentals in music theory, and I taught music appreciation. I taught wind band literature for graduate students. It was a lot to do and a lot to explore in that early stage of my college teaching career. It was really exciting.
Yeah. So how did that come up? How are you a student at North Texas, and then suddenly you have your first job at Texas El Paso?
Well, it's just a matter of, you know, you're in a job, and then, you know, jobs, you know, come open. And I wasn't really thinking about looking for that next step so soon, because I had only been in my doctorate program for a year. So that was really interesting. But after some consultations with my professors, I thought it would be a great choice and a good fit. And so when that opportunity came, I had to take it. So it's interesting because I wasn't looking for it. But I'm really glad I found it.
So now, you mentioned when we were talking about your high school teaching, you mentioned that sometimes you're just ready to move, or when you feel like you've kind of done everything that you can do. And so I have kind of like a two-part question about that, kind of tying it to the UTEP move. How do you know when it's time to move? And how do you keep yourself prepared to move when the time comes?
Wow. You know, it's, That's a very interesting question. I think you have to talk and communicate with your mentors. You have to talk, to your colleagues. You have to talk to your friends. Really get some outside input in that. I can't say for sure, honestly, Mark, if I was ready for that move after, you know, being at the University of North Texas for a year. I had certainly not maxed out that opportunity. It had just started. But it was an experience that I knew was going to help me in my career, in terms of I wanted to be in academia. Here was an opportunity for me to do that. I certainly could have passed it up, and maybe things would have been different, or maybe that would have been the same. And we never can tell. So those are not really good, you know, good thoughts to think about. But I think you have to think about what's in store for your future, what you are thinking of doing later in life, and see if those things match up. Now, I can say that as I was getting ready to depart, that was a different story. I think that was a mental state of knowing that you'd reached some great heights here. And again, I certainly wanted to continue my education and finish what I had started. So that was a matter of checking off some self boxes, for myself. But I think it's an individual case. Some people, stay in places for 45. For 45 years. One of my past mentors, upon his retirement, was at an institution for almost 30 years. And I say to him, I used to ask all the time, how do you know that's right? And he says, well, when it's right, you know it's right. And when it's time to leave, you also know, when it's time to leave. After, as he would say, having done a job well done.
Mm-hmm. Done all the things.
Yeah, done all the things that maybe you or the extremely long-term goals that you have set for your program and things that you have set for yourself. I absolutely hate moving, so in thinking about as I was coming to Colorado State University, a place that I have really come to love and think that I have fantastic colleagues and amazing resources and fantastic students. And I live in Fort Collins. The yeses on those boxes, continue to check. But also wanting to, for me personally, to be in a place where I feel that I can take roots and watch myself and the things that surround me grow simultaneously and be invested in those. And a lot of times, and I was certainly guilty of this in my younger days, of having great aspirations, to work at this place or to work at this place, all fueled by that great question of people say, well, what's your dream job? Well, I used to have a school that had an answer to that. Now my dream job is to be surrounded by great colleagues, surrounded by students who are excited about the music making process, being at a place where you feel that you have the resources to help both yourself and your students achieve their goals. That is the dream situation. So in those regards, my dream situation is very similar to the one I'm sitting in right now. It has all of those things. And now I'm just really invested in seeing that blossom. And I think that's very important. I want to retire like my teachers did, after a long stay, in doing something way bigger than myself.
Yeah, it's interesting that you use the word investment a few times. And, I've been in a pretty fortunate situation with my wife having a wonderful faculty job at a university. And it's given me the opportunity to explore and do different things. But the one thing that I've struggled with over the years being a part-timer, especially at the college level, is that the universities typically don't invest in their part-timers the way that we'd like them to. And so I never felt like I was fully part of something. And so that's always been something. And so I'm thinking about the band director who's in their first or their second job, and maybe they're feeling a little bit unhappy. And I'm wondering if we could talk a little bit more about how you know when you're supported.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think I advise people who are teaching in academia or who are teaching in the middle or high school setting, find some great colleagues that you gravitate towards, and spend a lot of time talking about not only the things that bind you and create great cohesion, but also your differences, and allow those to be healthy things, to really get you through. I think it's important that that people are connected, and you do get a sense of belonging from that. And of course, I think I never really hear teachers complaining about where they are because of the students. I think there are great students everywhere. Finding those great, finding those great colleagues, and sometimes they may not be, in your area. It could be the English teacher. It could be the history teacher that you that you rarely see because of your schedule. So, but I think you have to go out of your way to see who's in the building and how you connect and play off and play off of that. There is good everywhere, but you have to find it. And sometimes we're not patient enough to do that. And I've certainly been guilty of that myself.
Yeah, sure. I think about the places I've been. I've had some really wonderful colleagues. And one place in particular I missed, I'm sorry that I left because I had a great colleague. And, you have to kind of like look to people, not things.
Absolutely. It is more now in my frame of mind than ever that is very, very important. Who are you around? There are great students all across the all across the country. But what else do you need to really find that happiness? And happiness is certainly important. And in sometimes in odd ways, you have to work very hard to find that. Happiness sustains you. And so that could be, happiness in where you live. Are you taking enough walks? You have to find the good. You really, really, really do. I think in a world where everything is it's a quick fix and it's instant gratification. I think when you can find those things that deepen your love for something, your passion for something, your love for a place, your love for an area, your love for a community, I think there's great honor in that, and it's a necessity.
So Tiandre, you mentioned mentors a little bit earlier, and I do this show to help to bring guests like yourself into people's, wherever they are and bring them to them. And so I know when I was a young band director, I was in my 20s when I took my job, I had some people around who were looking out for me in sort of the region, but I never really felt connected to the people around me. What advice do you have for that director who's looking for mentors who maybe not have a whole lot beyond their college professors?
I think we're in the day and age where it's easy to pick up a phone. I think where it's easy to drop an email. And I think people would be absolutely surprised and stunned at the level of response and how I found that there's such a beautiful community at times where people are more than willing, whether you've been their former student or not, to have an investment in someone else. I say all the time that, not to downplay what we do at all, but we should be the kind of community that's really thinking about, people. Our job deals with people, and respecting one another and collaborating with one another. And I think we're all I would hope we're all wanting to do that and to be that, for someone. So whether a student is reaching out to me, one of my former students, or whether it's a student that I saw in passing that has a question, I never disregard those things because I understand the power of us being open and willing. I didn't get to where I am in my life by myself, and I'm not going to get to where I'm going in the future by myself. So I am always open and willing to share and collaborate. So I say, get on the phone, send an email, let people know that you have questions or you're not sure about this thing. I think you'll find that people are more than willing to share their experiences and how they overcame adversity. I think we all want to help. And so it won't come to you sometimes. I think sometimes you have to go to it and be unapologetic, about doing that. I have reached out many times, to people who were outside of my mentor circle who have, by weight of that process become huge mentors, in my life. And I wasn't their student, but they have allowed me, to come in, and I'm forever changed because of that. And so you gotta, put your feet forward and don't be afraid to do that. It's worth it.
Yeah. So what do you say to the person who is a band director and maybe not everything is the way they want it, and it's intimidating to invite someone like you in, and you're worried about what they're going to say? 'Cause you may say some hard things to someone that they need to hear.
I just had a student, Mark, that said, Dr. Feagin, it was really good to see you at Midwest, and I'm excited to make my band better so that you can come hear them. I think that's the mistake of the universe. Mm-hmm. If I had someone that was going to help me through the process, remember, that's one of the very first things we talked about, through the process. Are there things that I can be doing, should be doing to help better what it is that we're doing as a whole? I want to do that. So I think one of the biggest mistakes that young musicians make is we want to make something great before we ask for help. I'm not that guy. To this day, I'm asking for help for anyone who is offering. I want to have what you have, and I want this idea that you have, that you bring to the table, that I've never thought about. And wherever the ensemble is, that's where the ensemble is. I know, and it's such a big deal, because we feel that our ensemble's performances are a direct reflection of us. And to that note, that is partially true. However, in order, I think, to move that dial forward, you've got to be open and willing, to grow. And if someone coming in your room to tell you that your group is not doing so great helps you grow, so be it.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard to take that blow to the ego, to hear the criticism, but that's what makes us better.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I often say ego plays a great, I'd be lying if I didn't say ego plays a great deal into what we do. I mean, we're band directors, for crying out loud. We stand on podiums. It's above everything. We have large music stands, but in reality, we're trying to bring the people in front of you to where you are, and that does take some standing with them. And you got to be vulnerable. You have to be open. You have to be willing to grow. And as a great teacher, once said to me, the moment we think we're doing something spectacular, we have to remember that someone else can do it better. It's been one of the greatest lessons. And so we work hard to be better. We work hard to be able to provide our students with more. But sometimes, you have it, Mark, and I don't. And I'm not ashamed of coming to you, to ask what that is and how I can obtain that for the growth of my students.
Mm-hmm. Sure, absolutely. It's hard to do. One of the things that we talked about, my friend Demondre Thurman, the euphonium player who was guest on episode 6 or 8 of the show, and I mentioned this quote often, and his favorite quote is, "Don't let your ego get in the way of progress."
Oh, absolutely.
Because that's really what holds us back more than anything.
Absolutely. And in all sorts of ways, musically, professionally, and again, guilty as charged, and wanting to be the kind of person who's thinking about that and putting ego aside and getting back to the business of just being the best teacher possible and the best person that you can possibly be in the process. It really is, one of my, mentors, says that in the end, the only thing that matters is the music you make and the people that you make it with. That's really special. And if you can walk into your rehearsals and to your schools and to your business in your everyday lives, it's all about the people you're doing, whatever you're doing with. And if that's the only thing matters and that's sacred to you, and you help that environment become sacred to them, there's no greater gift.
T'Andre, have you worked much with composers as far as acquiring commissions?
Absolutely. That's super exciting. And as I used to say a long time ago, as it started that process a little bit at Watkins Overton with Carl Holmquist, who did a great commission for us during my departure of the school. But having the opportunity for students to be invested in that process and have something that's being written for them, and then even better to have the ability to to visit and to collaborate with that composer. I believe, you know, you just had John Mackey on your show.
And well, he's actually going to be after you chronologically.
Oh, he's going to be after me. But like, you know, for example, I've had him out and had the opportunity to watch what happens when the living, breathing composer is sitting in the room, really, you know, listening, you know, critically to what the ensemble is delivering and watching that student to composer engagement, and then watching the conductor to composer engagement. I think that it's really special and it's really profound. You know, we are the majority of our profession, and think about what we studied in school. You know, wouldn't it be wonderful to email Mozart and Beethoven and Brahms and Mahler, you know, people who we have a great respect for, who we're so far removed from. And then we have this live living art form. You know, I can rehearse a piece by my colleague Jim David and walk down the hall and talk with him about his compositional process, and then having him share that with the ensemble. I think that's really special. I also think that's why in the band world today, it's so popular. It's you know, more popular, I think, today than I can ever remember. Tons of consortiums, tons of new music being written, and tons of student engagement with that composer, and tons of engagement from conductor to the composer. It's great. It's a wonderful collaborative process.
And so what advice would you give to the teacher who might want to do a commission or put together a consortium for a new piece of new music? Any thoughts on that, how they could get started?
You know, I think that finding a composer whose music you really believe in, and getting a group of your colleagues, be it mini band programs, to put something together. I think it starts with, though, again, that point that I just made, you know, finding something that you believe in. You know, our taste is so subjective, and I understand that, but what music speaks to you? Has this composer written anything of that nature? What can be contributed to the literature, with the vast amount of literature that's you know, being added to the repertoire? What can you kind of help encourage that's going to be lasting? I think that I think that those things are very important. But it starts with, you know, finding something that speaks to you, and then collaborative efforts with, you know, with colleagues maybe around your district or within your district or across the country, as you know, as we see, you know, to have a new piece of music. I'm always excited about that process, especially when it comes from composers whose music I'm really, really excited about.
Do you have any good stories of commissions? Any good anecdotes?
Good stories of commissions. James Thomas Naylor did a work a few years ago called Yes, I Want to Cross Over. And in that process, I was really excited. It wasn't my first commission or consortium to be a part of, but it was probably the first where I had the most interaction in the process. And that was really exciting to just talk about what was next. And it as much as possible, this composer was really interested, you know, in us understanding how his music was developing over time. And so as we were putting it together, I remember it was being put on a Black History Month program. This was while I was teaching at UTEP. We recorded this piece. We had worked really hard on it, and you know, it was new and it was exciting. And I don't think yet the students understood its impact until the concert was over and we took a listen to the recording. But we recorded the project again a few days later, and we sent this to the composer. And I think that was probably the most exciting, was the feedback we got back about the way in which we performed his piece. And I was just really excited for the students who were involved in that process. and really got to hear from a composer who had listened to us really work hard on bringing his piece of music to life. And he was very complimentary about the way the students were, you know, the way the students were playing and some musical ideas that were being brought forth and highlighted that he hadn't necessarily considered. That was really fun. You know, as much as we know that the composers know and put their energy into their music, it's really awesome too when the ensemble can bring something else out, to the composer. So that was a really, really, really wonderful experience. I need to do that piece again, with my students now. But that collaborative effort and that conversation back and forth, specifically in the end, and just to have that sensation of feeling so pleased with that we had done a good job, for that composer. Without throwing myself, out into a tangent, that's another important idea as well in the music making process, is that we're vulnerable, to these composers. And it's one of the reasons why I feel I'm probably as aggressive as I am in rehearsal about the music making, is because it doesn't belong to me. It will belong to all of us in the end, but our objective is to use this limited notation and get these ideas and these expressive qualities out that the composer intended, and to get us out of the way, so that we can bring that composer forward. And I think that is one of the challenges in the music making process. But when you can do that, I think it's really special. Music making, although it's a great collaborative effort and we enjoy that, it's the most selfless act possible. And I love that. It's just someone else's music that you're bringing to life, and you're adamant about, doing that. We as conductors are the composer's advocate. That is our number one job, is to make sure that this music is speaking the truth from this composer. And I really slave over that idea. I really do. It keeps me up at night. But it also wakes me up in the morning, thinking that we can get closer to bringing this idea that this composer has put on paper, to life sonically.
So it sounds like you're just really passionate about being a composer's advocate.
That's what we're here for. That is what we do. And so when you're looking for the details and for understanding the nuance, that takes a lot of study, that takes a lot of concentration, that takes a lot of research, so that you can bring that music, to life. And I say this often, and my students, they look at me like I'm crazy. It's not this isn't how I want the piece to sound. Through study, this is how I feel that the composer wishes this piece to sound. And the energy that I feel that always comes out of that honesty is remarkable. And I think that kind of approach into the music making process, is very, very important. And I had touched on this before, but it's a selfless act. And I adore that it's a selfless act. So we get to walk into rehearsal, we get to walk into concerts, and it's not about us. It's about bringing this composer to life and sharing his story through us as a vessel, sharing his story, her story, to the audience. I think it's remarkable. And as I go into each rehearsal, I'm thinking about that to a great, great, great deal.
What harder lesson would you want to share with my listeners?
It's okay to be wrong. It's okay to say you're sorry, and it's okay to move forward. Those are biggies. We're in a profession, and we serve a role where our major objective is to be right and to dictate and to lead. But I think that when students and your colleagues see that there is a person behind the occupation, I think that is super powerful. I also think, and would be an advocate of building honest relationships and living and learning as you're through those. And I know that that has absolutely nothing to do with music per se, but I think that it has a direct impact on your music making process and the atmosphere and environment that you are creating, whether that's in the class, where you hope to create this level, this two-way street of mutual respect and honesty. I think that's an important lesson that, you know, we don't talk about enough, but it's so important. I think we'll change your environment, as we were mentioning, you know, as we were talking about before. You know, sometimes when you don't feel like, you know, things are going right, are you honest enough with yourself to sometimes take that hard look in the mirror to see that, you know, maybe you're a part of that? And what can you be doing to make things a little better, both for yourself, for the students you teach, for the colleagues, you know, you're around? I think that's very important. We've got to be accountable, and responsible for us. And, I think that goes into every profession, that goes into every communication, that goes into every relationship. And I think that if that can be at the foreground of people's thought process, that every person you deal with is indeed a person. And with all of the, you know, I think the rights of respect that go with that, we owe that to ourselves. And we owe that, you know, to the people around us. And if I could go back and be me again, it would be with a greater understanding of that idea.
So, Tiandre, before we start our final questions, is there anything that I missed? Anything you want to talk about?
No. Yes, I want to make sure that I get this name right. I think in the opening of this work, that I was a part of the consortium at the University of Texas at El Paso, is not by James Taylor. His name is Craig Thomas Naylor. Craig Thomas Naylor for the work "Yes, I Want to Cross Over." So I want to make sure that's correct. It's a great piece, and I'm super embarrassed that I got his name wrong. Yeah, it's "Yes, I Want to Cross Over." Craig Thomas Naylor. Check it out.
Where do you draw the line between healthy and unhealthy competition in music?
Well, I draw the line when it stops being about the music. And I understand, you know, like historically, you know, the wind band contest in America at the turn of the 20th century, I believe started with all the correct intentions of, you know, what does the best band in America, you know, sound like? I think that a lot of times, especially in the marching arts, we've taken that to the extreme. It doesn't really have anything to do with the music. It has everything to do with the trophy, you know, you get later. So as competitive of a person that I am, I do know that in the end, that really doesn't matter. Through the music making process and experience, does that student love music a little more? Does that student understand music a little more? For me, those things have nothing to do with competition. And so for those who love the contest, and I'm not knocking that, I'm just saying, we have to think about the educational value behind them. And I really feel that I can say without a doubt that as educationally sound as we'd like to be, the competitive nature that I see and adjudicate, you know, now, is the music emphasis. We've really stepped aside from that. And so that's something that I would love to see us, you know, to see us come back to. So my line is anything that is taking us away from the music making process. I know students who compete constantly. And as soon as they leave, sometimes the high school setting, they never want to play their instrument again. And I have a problem with that. That wasn't the reason why, music is there. And we've created such a need and desire to create the best band with the number one spot and the trophy besides the best lovers of music. And so I just like to us, you know, to find the healthy, you know, balance between that. You know, maybe you don't do, you know, 8 marching contests in a year. Maybe you just do 1. And then maybe you continue to express the collaborative effort and the community that, you know, surrounds their participation. I hope that answered the question.
T'Andre, one of the things that band directors often joke about, and it's kind of a sad joke, is that we're always the last car in the parking lot.
It's so true. It's so true.
So how do we be better? How do we find a work-life balance?
Well, I think that you being the last car in the parking lot shows great leadership, and you should continue to do that. But what you should do is that when you get home, you should be home. That is something that I have learned over the past 4 years about being able to leave work at work. And as much as we want to get ahead and plan, find another opportunity to do that little by little. I think it's very important that besides being great band directors, you allow yourself to be human and to have as much of a normal life as possible. And I know that sounds crazy because people have music to write and they have drill to finish and schedules to send out. You know, kind of divide your time up a little more wisely during the day so that when you are the last car in the parking lot, you can get in your car knowing that when you walk through the thresholds of your home, you can be home. It has been something that I have been practicing, and it's great and does wonders for me being able to be excited and inspired and fired up about going to work the next day instead of, you know, sometimes that dreading atmosphere because you haven't allowed yourself to be off work. So you have to, yeah, teachers, force yourself to do that. Force yourself to do that. You know, how do you sustain a life of this, a life of dealing with administration and parents and students? You have to have lived yourself. So make sure that you find an opportunity to do that. You have to do that. That's the greatest, I think, advice ever.
All right. So what, in your estimation, are the greatest challenges facing music and or music education as we move forward in the 21st century?
I think it's this idea that we haven't taught our administrations and our community how important it is. I think that's a huge challenge. So, and I think a way that we can meet those is by doing some things that it involve the community. You know, have your program, you know, have a performance in the park or something that engages the community. I see a lot of and hear a lot of you know, advertising of, you know, we've got to make band, you know, special. And, you know, and we've done crazy things. You know, sometimes we've got, you know, we've got the electronic component now. We've got, you can have lights in it. Your concerts can now be over the top. And then, but sometimes they're meaningless when we do that, because the community doesn't understand, you know, who you are. So even, you know, from the high school band standpoint, from the middle school band standpoint, there are opportunities in our community where we get to teach the community what it is that we do and why it's important, a way to tell your story. And oftentimes that's not told when you're, you know, when you're going to contests every week. People just know that you go to contests, you know, every week. But what's the merit behind that? So I think that's a huge challenge. And I think that's going to go along with programs being supported. Create an environment around your program and in your community where it will be the last thing that people want to, you know, to talk about for budget cuts and for the removal of classes. Have you moved your artistic element, you know, to the foreground in your school and in your communities and in your upper administration's way of life so that they see the impact that it's making? You know, a lot of times, you know, when it's time to scream about, you know, budget cuts, it's a little too late. And now we want to be active. I say you have to be active now. You have to tell people constantly how important it is, how much it matters. And if that's a consistent speech, then that's that we remain consistent thought, you know, instead of being the first. Well, what's this thing? What happens down here? What happens in, you know, down this hallway? We can afford to get rid of that. No, you can't. This thing is about the building of people. And look at the work that we do, both in our school and in the community, you know, that make that special. So, you know, for me, it's the education behind the education to others outside of the band of what it is that we do and the purpose that we serve. I think that's huge.
So you've already been very great about being introspective about mistakes that you've made, and you gave me some really good advice there. But I want to ask you kind of that question in a different way. And if you could go back to your high school graduation and give some advice to your 18-year-old self, what would you say?
I would say that you're about to make a lot of mistakes. Don't freak out. Take each one of them and note them, not only for the mistake that it is, but for the lesson that is to be learned from it, and keep storing those. And as you have the opportunity to live longer, you know, a great quote by Maya Angelou, who says, when we know better, we do better. And so to keep that constant, mantra in your mind, that through life and through experience and through meeting people, you're going to do some things right and you're going to do some things wrong. You should beat yourself up for about 30 seconds, and then you should think about the good that you can get out of that. And then you should press forward. I think that it's good. And I think that it's healthy. I beat myself up a lot over a lot of things, and in the past have done that to the extent of where it's unhealthy. So I would just tell myself that, you know, 18-year-old, you know, T'Andre, you're going to do some things way wrong. And in the process of doing those things way wrong, dude, you're going to have the opportunity to really be better as a person, you know, and as a teacher. I think that's the greatest gift, allowing yourself the vulnerability, you know, to be human.
If you had a choice, what would be the final work you'd conduct?
David Meslenka's Fourth Symphony.
Why?
Two reasons. I love David Meslenka's music. I think of every composer that I've ever encountered musically. It speaks to me like nothing else ever has. It's so powerful. I believe that my ability and fantastic opportunity to get to know him as a person and as a musician really had a deep impact on my life. And that was the first piece that I ever played by him, and the first piece that ever paralyzed me. And I say that in the most positive fashion. I remember sitting on a stage in a wind ensemble performing that work at a convention, and was paralyzed in the final 40 seconds. And my face, you know, there are tears running down my face, and I can't explain it. And I remember looking across the ensemble to see that infectious energy was happening all around me. And for me, that only comes through music that is just so pure and so honest and so powerful. That piece was like nothing I had ever experienced up to that point. And every time I hear it, it moves me with the same kind of vigor that it did the very, very first time. And, you know, to be able to explain it, you know, I think in greater detail will send me into tears now just thinking about it. It's that powerful. So without a doubt, you know, Symphony Number 4.
I don't like to say what I think is great and not on the show, because I like to try to be magnanimous about everything. But it is, if it's not the greatest work for the genre, it's really close to being.
I'm telling you, I will argue someone in a parking lot. For me, the three greatest works of all time came out of the same guy. And And it's not Holst. And it's not Granger, and that doesn't take away from the, you know, the dynamic range of those pieces. But something that gets in the core of you and sits, David Maslanka, every time, you know, Symphony 4, Symphony 7, Symphony 2. Oh my goodness.
David was really special. I had the pleasure and the misfortune of only really having a chance to talk to him for about an hour, but I had an hour where he and I had lunch alone, and boy, that he said so much in that hour by saying so little.
That's one of the things that I too learned from him, just the honesty, you know, behind music making. And I mean, you've had an opportunity, you know, to speak with him, but like to get to know that peaceful, gentle soul, and to hear what roars out of him, I can't even explain it. But absolutely breathtaking. Absolutely breathtaking. I was so very fortunate to have the connection that I did with, you know, with him through one of my mentors. It's life changing, forever changed. But I'm so lucky, you know, to have that. To have that music touch me the way it does.
All right, T'Andre, is there anything coming up that you'd like to share or promote?
Well, I'm always interested in sharing all things Colorado State University because, hey, we are proud to be here and proud to be CSU Rams. I have a concert coming up on the 4th of March, and I'm super excited about it. The program is titled History, and we're using a lot of historical things, opera, a French satire, American patriotism, and a tribute to Black History Month on that program that I'm just super, super excited about. My group will be performing Omar Thomas's Of Our New Day Begun, and I'm really, really excited about sharing that with our community. It's a beautiful work, and I'm looking forward to that concert. So March 4th. Is when that concert is, and we're super excited about it. We're still not in school yet, so I think everyone is almost back to work, and you know, we still have a little bit of time, but I can't wait to get back to get going.
Excellent. How can people get in touch with you?
You can email me at t.feagin, F-E-A-G-I-N, at Colostate, colostate.edu. That's the best way to get in touch with me, or, you know, find me on Facebook.
Excellent. T'Andre, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate this honor.